Thanks so much for sharing your garden with us. We're now going to turn to an important topic, soils and getting your soil tested for different contaminants. I'm joined by Christine Whitney from the City of Austin Brownfields Program, where she's the director. Brownfields means a kind of industrial areas in most people's minds, or a land that's been abused and used in the past, right?
It could be any property that has a potential to be contaminated mm-hmm. from any historic use, or an adjacent property could be have potentially contaminated it.
All right.
So it's just that you don't know what the historic use is or that the mm-hmm. historic use could have impacted it.
Well, I know in the various properties I've lived in Austin, the past uses were not residential. There are other uses. So there might be concern about what was in the ground as a result of those kinds of uses. And you're recommending that people do soil testing. And we've heard, you know, all sorts of ideas about soil testing in the past, but you have a specific target in mind here to look for some of these kind of contaminants, right?
Right. Well, we provide, at an annual event, the Soil Kitchen, we provide free testing for heavy metals, and we also do soil nutrient testing. Mm-hmm. And the reason being for the metals is that the heavy metals is that people have contamination or might have contamination and they don't realize it's there. Mm-hmm. And that could be from lead-based paint on their buildings, or there could have been treated lumber in your backyard mm-hmm. from your deck or a playscape.
Or asbestos siding that's sloughed off or something like that?
But that wouldn't show up as heavy metals.
Okay. There are a lot of different potential things.
Sure. And if property was historically farmland, pesticide use, it typically had arsenic in it.
Yeah.
So, and if you're near a busy road, then lead-based leaded gasoline used to be an issue. Oh. But the lead is pervasive. It is still there.
Wow. And, you know, that's something for people to realize that I certainly was unaware. I thought that if you were kind to the soil for year after year and you added organic amendments and were really working the soil, mm-hmm. that would dissipate problems. You wouldn't face things like lead contamination, but what you were telling me is that the lead persists, correct?
It does. It will still be there.
Okay, so this is important news for home gardeners, especially for those who are doing fruit production or vegetable production, mm-hmm. right? Should horticultural gardeners, people who are just doing landscaping, be concerned? Are there precautions that they would need to take if the tests come back?
Sure, we have that on our website at austinbrownfields.com, but it's best practices because it isn't so much just, well, if it's just ornamental plants, mm-hmm. but vegetables don't really take up lead, for example, very
easily.
Oh,
that's good news.
but other things like cadmium, mm-hmm. they're more prone to taking it up, but that doesn't mean you're not exposed because people eat root vegetables that they don't necessarily peel mm-hmm. or leafy vegetables where it's really easy for some dust to get stuck in or mm-hmm. it gets on your clothes or on your pet that goes outside and comes back in your house and then you have dust.
Okay.
So, and it's easy for small children to be out in the yard, and mm-hmm. where do kids put their fingers? In their mouths.
Okay.
So, it's easier to be exposed to the lead in your soil than mm-hmm. just through eating your fruit.
Is this really
vegetables.
A question of helping people just be aware of potential dangers, or are there remediations or steps that it could actually take to help?
There are steps such as adding compost or putting down paving stones to step on mm-hmm. or doing raised beds.
Okay.
And just making sure, the things that make sense, wearing gloves, making sure that you're not tracking in dust into your house or soil.
Mm-hmm.
And
okay.
And again, that's listed on our website.
Okay.
But just common sense kind of items.
Well, that's good to know that once contaminated doesn't mean permanent that you need to wear a hazmat suit out to the backyard. Probably would not be the most popular thing to do. But so let's talk a little bit about how you're testing the soils and again explicitly what kinds of things pop up when you do one of these kinds of tests. You mentioned lead and cadmium. I'm not too familiar with what the dangers of cadmium are, but
kidney disease.
You can stop there.
Okay.
I'm convinced. Okay, we need to test for cadmium. But what are some of the other things that are common contaminants in the soil?
Other than arsenic, lead, barium, cadmium, zinc, chromium, mercury.
Wow. Okay, a whole host of stuff.
Sure.
Okay, and should people be particularly concerned if, you know, if they live in like the central city as opposed to new suburbs, or what would be the difference between those kinds of scenarios?
Well, really, it's hard to know what your property could have been before. It could have been an unofficial dumping ground that you didn't know about before it was developed. It could have been farmland that pesticide use. It could have had a cattle dip if it was farmland, which that was arsenic-based way back in the day. And even if it is a residential area now, it doesn't mean that 50, 80 years ago, it still was.
Right.
And if you have a new house, it doesn't mean that there wasn't an old house there before with lead-based paint or treated lumber. So it's just good to know what you're starting with. And that's the same with soil nutrients. Because even if you say, well, adding compost is a good idea, or if you're not adding fertilizer, but did the person that lived there before add a lot of nutrients?
Right.
Or did they add a lot of fertilizer? It's just good to know where you're starting at. And we also get the pH results.
Okay.
And so that at least lets you know where you're starting from. The soil around Austin, for example, is highly alkaline.
Yeah.
So if you're buying plants that like more neutral soil, then you're not going to be successful. Or acidic-loving plants.
Azaleas, bad idea.
then you're just not going to be successful. And some people think, oh, my plant is not being very successful. And they think, fertilize, fertilize, fertilize. And that's not helpful.
Or that they could actually change the pH. And that's a subject of great interest. Can somebody, by amending the soil, by using something like soil sulfur, et cetera, can they actually significantly impact the pH level?
Yes, you can.
Okay.
But you can also add pine needles.
Okay, all right.
It's harder, I think, well, you would know better about this, but isn't it harder to turn it more neutral from alkaline than it is to make it? Because you can put a lot of lime in your soil much easier than you can move it.
I don't know anybody who puts lime in their soil in Central Texas.
Not in Central Texas.
No.
But going in the opposite direction is easier than trying to make it more neutral from from alkaline.
Okay, but I like your suggestion of pine needles and things like that, pine bark, you know, and so, so I'm hearing soil sulfur is can be a successful medium for.
Sure, it just might take several years.
Don't expect overnight results.
Don't expect overnight results.
Right.
So, for example, in Austin, and probably many communities around the United States do this, we do Christmas tree recycling and grinding.
Yeah, right.
And so every year in mid-January, you can go and pick up free mulch, free pine mulch.
Right.
And so that is helpful if you know, hey, I want to move it a little bit and it smells good. So that's a good thing to put in front of your house.
And that's something that a lot of Austin led the way on that, but now that's almost nationwide, I think, the Christmas tree recycling. Hopefully everybody's giving that mulch away. A lot of people use it in their parks as well.
Oh, okay.
You know, but still, great resource available. And there are other great resources that are available through the city of Austin where you can pick up mulch and things like that as well. So encourage people to do that. Now, you referenced briefly a little while ago the cooking.
Can I interrupt? We should have said that the mulch is available.
Okay.
Austin Resource Recovery.
Okay, yeah.
And you can find out information about that on Austin Resource.
Okay, cool. Well, there's a fair coming up in April where you do the testing and people can come and talk to you.
Right.
Just very briefly, tell me about that.
The East Austin Garden Fair, we'll be doing our fourth annual soil kitchen at that event.
All right, so we've talked about a very serious issue here. How can people around the country outside of Austin learn where to get their soil tested?
There are brownfields programs across the nation at the state and local level, so you just need to look them up.
All right. Well, I know they're going to be easily found on the internet, so thank you so much for being our guest. And now it's time for Daphne.